Hi, I hope this is broadcasting. Can somebody let me know if this is broadcasting? Hello? I think this is broadcasting. Hopefully it is. Anyway, hello, my name is Sarah Rice, and I have been playing the theremin for about 6 years now. I started in 2014, and so this is great. This is great. Okay, Peter, thank you. I didn't realize that this was a Facebook Live, which I've never done. This is the first time. So, hello, Ampliva, Katiana. And here it is. Hello. It's so nice to be with you. Hello. So anyway, and I thought that this was going to be like a Zoom meeting where, you know, Peter and everybody else would like ask the questions and I would respond. But it's a Facebook Live. So this is me in front of my pantry door in New York City. And I will read the questions here, which is why I have to have my glasses on. And I will answer them to the best of my knowledge at the moment. All right, so we're gonna start. Thank you all for joining me today. And I'm just thrilled to be part of this. Thank you, Peter, for asking me to be part of this. I love our theremin community. And I am so proud to be part of it. And I am really thrilled with how much interest there is in the theremin. Hold on, I'm gonna move my selfie light just a little bit because it's going into my glasses and I had to move it and I need to change it back here. Hold on. It's one of those weird things, it starts to look like the mothership. Is that better? Is that better? So let me know. Hi, Masha, good to see you. Thank you for joining me today. All right, so all these questions that you've been dying to know about me, I will answer to the best of my ability, and here we go. So these questions are from Peter Theremin. Dear Sarah, how did I spend my time in self-isolation? Well, I'm still sort of in self-isolation right now. As you know, New York was a hot spot for the virus, and I got it. I got the COVID virus very, very early on in March, mid-March, and I was pretty sick from it, although thank goodness I did not get the pneumonia. So my lungs were not affected. Hold on, I'm just gonna keep switching this a little. This is all a learning curve. Is that better? Anyway, I was very sick from it, but I did not get the pneumonia, thank God. And it's taken me actually about 3 months to recover from it to where I wasn't so fatigued that I had to sleep 15 hours a day. So I haven't done much. I haven't become bored because I was sleeping all the time. It really debilitates you. I hope that you all are staying safe and being well and wearing your masks and stuff. You know, I caught it before they knew what was going on, you know, because I was taking public transportation. I was doing public performances. I was in cabaret spaces with a lot of other people. So goodness only knows where I caught it. But now, for the last month or so, I'm finally recovering. I lost my sense of taste and smell and all, you know, all the typical stuff. But I, you know, so luckily I don't think I'm having too many lingering ramifications once I got over the really bad fatigue. But, you know, so now I'm getting back into music again. I didn't sing for like 3 months. I didn't play the theremin for 3 months because I was too tired. It was like, you know, making sure the cats were fed and taking a bath every day, and that was about all I could handle. But, you know, life is looking up. I have the antibodies, yay, I feel like Wonder Woman, because I have the antibodies for the moment. Who knows how long they will last, but for the moment, I can, the fear is lifted of getting this. And I still, when I go out, I still wear the mask, I still do the protocol, I wash my hands, you know, and I pretty much still sequester. Getting back into singing again, the church gig that I have, we've started Zooming the church services, so they're having us come there, and we're all by ourselves. It's all very socially distanced, and I don't, you know, we're not with anybody else there, so we Zoom that, no congregation or anything, and the minister is actually in a whole different place. So, excuse me, I've started singing again, which feels really strange, but okay, you know, it's like we're all trying to get back to normal. So that was a very long-winded explanation as to what I've been doing with my sequestering time. And I'm still sequestering and still kind of self-isolating until they know more what the things are. And again, I just hope that you all stay safe, and if you get it, that it be very mild for you. Okay, have I heard the new album of Clara Rockmore, Music and Memories? No, I have not. Again, I have not been on YouTube much because I just am trying to get through the day. But I will listen to it because I'm a huge fan, and I think she's my goddess. She's my theremin goddess, and musical goddess. And so definitely I'm very interested in that. What do I think about the role of Clara Rockmore in the theremin history and nowadays? She was phenomenal. Her musicianship was so incredible, and of course she was Lev's muse. And she was my inspiration. I think she's amazing. I love her musicality, her musicianship. Obviously, you know, she was world class that way. I think, you know, even people who are not who are not familiar with the theremin, they would listen to her and they'd go, oh my God, that is so beautiful, because she really made it sing in a way that, because of her musicianship and her musicality, I think her phrasing is just phenomenal. And she lived it. She lived it and she breathed it. And it was a part of her in a way that very few of us could have today. And she didn't have YouTube videos to watch to learn how to play it. I mean, she had to figure it all out herself, because her technique is very different from the way Lev would play. You know, I mean, she didn't play it this way. And she was the one that I watched for technical things of, you know, how she did things. Of course, the vibrato is very different from our vibrato, how we like a vibrato today. It was that 1930s vibrato, you know, even the sopranos had that kind of fast vibrato, and even violinists had a faster vibrato, which we don't do so much today. We like a slower vibrato. So it's just figuring all that out. But I think she's a major influence, and I think I'm so glad that there are so many YouTube videos where she can be heard, because anyone who listens to her is so struck by the humanity in her music making. She really communicates through the theremin, And she and her sister, Nadia, had such humanity in their playing and their musicianship. And I just, you know, it's just something to aspire to. I fail miserably even approaching that kind of thing, but I try, you know, it's something to aspire to. Do we have thereminists of Clara's level today? I think we have many, many fabulous thereminists. You know, I mean, we're comparing ourselves today with, you know, the 60 years that she played, and I don't think that that's a fair comparison. Just like, you know, the singers of today, everybody brings their own unique take on what they bring to the theremin and what they use the theremin for. And I love the fact that I think we have many, many fine thereminists, you know, of course, Carolina Eich, and Rob Schwimmer is another one, Amethyst Spardell is another one, Gladys, you know, you're really fabulous, and, you know, I'm just trying to think off the top of my head, quickly, I love Pamelia, I love her stuff too, you know, and she brings more of a kind of a jazz thing to it. I mean, I use her technique for the bass playing, and I, you know, Claire Rockmore's technique book was very helpful to me in the beginning, and then Carolina's book also was extremely helpful. You know, I was looking for something clean and efficient, because I wanted to play the theremin classically. I'm a singer and I sing classically, and I wanted to sort of, that's where my mind goes, although I love the jazz too. It's fun to play jazz sometimes on it. And I love the fact that people are experimenting and trying all these different things with it, you know, different sounds and different ways of expressing. And, you know, please forgive me if I've left anybody. I think that there are lots of us, and I'm so pleased that we kind of congregate together and help each other get better. You know, but I mean, you know, I guess, Lydia too is another one that's really fabulous, and I love her, and she's been very generous to me in sharing music, when you can't find it anyplace. You know, and, you know, and everybody has a different technique a little bit, and the way that they use it, because everybody's built differently. And, you know, what works for one isn't necessarily going to work for another. Oh, Torvald is another one, who, oh my God, you know, to watch him grow up through the years of his proficiency, because he loves to practice. You know, he loves to practice, and it shows. And he's just, he's become another phenomenal, you know, his stuff is very clean, and, you know, and his technique is his own. I couldn't do what he does, because my hands are a different size. I'm a different build. I'm a different everything. And so I'm really thrilled that people are bringing their own, what draws them to it musically, that they're bringing their own thing, and they're experimenting around and trying to find new ways of using the theremin to express what they need to express musically. It's fabulous, and I love that. So yes, also Katika. Yeah, the Hungarian violin virtuosa, and who also plays the theremin extremely well, because whatever she does well. She tap dances, she does all that stuff. I love her, and you know, it's just great to hear it being used in so many different ways, and it's all wonderful, and people enjoy it, and you know, she gets to play with an orchestra. I'm so jealous. I have to use tracks, because, or a pianist. You know, I don't have an orchestra at my disposal. But you know, I admire. The thing about Katika is that because she's so disciplined, because she is that virtuosa thing, and that takes incredible practice and everything else, you know, she navigated very quickly once she started doing the theremin. And, you know, it's fun to hear what she comes up with as well. So, and Amethyst with the new age stuff, and Hirtus and everybody, you know, it's all very cool. I'm so thrilled. It's not something that, you know, 12-year-old boys only play, wanting to be Led Zeppelin and, you know, making noise with it. And so that thrills me. So that's another very long-winded answer to, do we have thereminists of Clara's level? You know, I think everybody's finding their level. Everybody's trying to be as good as they can. What Clara had was very unique. I don't know that anybody could be that exactly. As Julie Andrews used to say, you know, I can't be a second-rate somebody else. I have to be a first-rate me. And I think, you know, we just need to remember that, you know, Clara had a lifetime of this. And part of it is because it's very hard to make a living from it. I think Torvald is probably the only one who does an actual living from it. You know, you have to be doing other things as well, and it makes it hard to practice in the way that you really need to. And you know, even with singing, you know, when I first came to the city and I had to do day jobs, you know, and I'd work 10 hours a day and come home exhausted, and it was like the last thing I wanted to do was practice singing. So it's a trade-off for those of us who are not financially independent and able to just concentrate solely, because it does take a lot of practice. You know, it's not something that you can just kind of get lucky with. Even the really advanced musicians are still have to work very hard at it, to because it requires a lot. So I don't know that we'll ever find somebody that is another Clara. I really don't, because her situation was so unique. But it doesn't mean that people aren't just as good in their way and what they need to express. So anyway, that's my answer, and I'm sticking to it. Could you please tell us about my personal theremin approach? Okay, again, I watched a billion YouTubes to see the different way people played, and if I liked someone's playing, I would try to emulate that. And then you have to find your own way. I just recently lost 65 pounds, and so my boobs got a lot smaller, and that made a huge difference in how I played the theremin, because I don't have the stomach that I had, and I don't have the boobs that I had. I joke that I went from a, you know, a 40 triple D to a 36 long, you know. But it's your physicality makes such a difference in how the theremin responds to you, and so my approach is as a classical thereminist, even though I like to play in different styles, and because I'm a singer, my phrasing is like a singer. If I was a violinist, my phrasing would be more like a violinist. And Pamelia, for instance, is a bass player, and so her phrasing is very much like a bass player. She's fabulous. And you know, Amethyst is a singer. Rob is a pianist singer. You know, so his phrasing is different. Everybody's phrasing is very different. Katika, you know, phrases like a violinist, like a string player. And it's just interesting to me how different people phrase. And Carolina also is a string a violist. And she phrases like a string player. She's very instrumental in her singing and her playing. Whereas I tend to go for the emotion, sometimes to the detriment of the technique, and that's learning the balance of how do you put emotion into it and still keep your technique. And so my approach to the theremin is to look at everybody, pick what I like from people, and then see how my own body responds to it. I like Carolina's technique in that it's clean and I can be facile with it in a way that just doing this you can't. You know, this thing with the fingers, which was also Clara. I don't know what the Russian technique is, but you find what works for you. I broke my arm 5 years ago, and that changed everything for me with the theremin, because I couldn't, because of the bone that I broke, and it healed differently. I can't move it as far this way as I used to be able to. So that took a little adjusting, but you know, life happens and you adjust. You know, Clara had terrible, I guess, arthritis and rickets, and that, you know, affects your playing too. So it's an adjustment. But my approach is more of a classical thereminist. I love playing classical music on it. And it's fun to do jazz in different styles too. I stole Pamelia's walking bass technique, which also is great for staccati. You know, I've been, just as a test for myself, I've been working on Queen of the Night, because I've sung it, so I know the notes. And the staccati, this way of, I guess it's this hand for me, this, doing this in the volume thing, you get a very clean staccati. And it was like, and that's because of Pamelia. So we all do our thing, you know, and you find a vibrato that's pleasing to you, which I still work on, because when I get nervous, of course, everything tenses up and I get, the vibrato can sometimes get a little machine gunny. So I've been working very hard on doing a very nice, smooth vibrato. And that, you know, and managing nerves. Part of it is just managing nerves. I do a lot of live performing with it. And oh my God, you know, the things that you learn never to do again are really valuable. I figure I've been through most of them, and then I'll discover something new that it's like, oh, well, you don't do that again. The first time I ever played with an orchestra, they put me in the crook of the piano, and then they raised the lid, and I couldn't hear a thing. And I didn't, it was before I got the pitch preview, so I couldn't hear anything. And it was random, and it's on YouTube, and it's really embarrassing, and I'm so embarrassed, but I didn't know that that was gonna happen. Another performance that I did, we had done the sound check, and I could hear everything. Everything was fine. They had a monitor for me, and I could hear the monitor and the pitch of the theremin. And then during dinner break, they did something to where I couldn't hear the band, and I couldn't hear the singers. And so all I could hear was me. I didn't know what key I was in, because when you're only hearing part of the sound, it sometimes sounds like it's in a whole different key. And so it took me a verse to kind of figure out what key we were in, because it sounded like they were in a completely different key. So that was another thing that I learned. You know, you just learn all these little ways of trying to circumvent problems and issues, and there's a billion of them. And it always amazes me how these things happen in new and interesting ways with stuff. I try to be as self-contained as possible. And now I had Charlie Hobbs put in a pitch preview in my theremin, ether wave, and because the subscopes come with a pitch preview, thank God. But I like also the sound of the ether wave for certain things, and so he put a pitch preview in there, and it's like, thank you, Jesus, because it works so well to at least know where you are. And then I use Aftershocks makes bone conduction headphones, which leaves the ear open. And it's like here, and of course I can hide it under my hair. It looks very Star Trek. So I can hear the pitch preview. And that's very helpful because I like to have my ears open. When I had the earbud, the single earbud, it was hard. It was hard to hear the center of the pitch a little bit. And a cellist friend of mine said, who plays in a lot of Broadway pits, and she said, I got the bone induction headphones because then both ears are open, and then you. It feels right in the center of your head. You can actually hear what you're doing, as opposed to having one thing blocked off, and then it's like, where's the pitch? Where's the center of the pitch? So Aftershocks makes them. They're about $30, and they're very, very helpful with the Theremin for those that have the pitch preview. And I could not live without the pitch preview. I've done... I've had to do pitch fishing, and it's hard. It's really, really hard. You develop the technique for it, but it's harder. It's so much easier with a pitch preview. So I think everybody should have one. It just makes your life so much easier, and anything that's going to make your life easier with the Theremin, I say go for it. And I like to stand against something solid. I'm trying to learn how to sit and play, but what I really like is to stand, because then I can stand in the crook of a piano for concert with the lid closed, thank you, and I can brace myself so I can be steady, because I weave. I am a weaver when I sing, and it's part of what you do, and for me, to be that rigidly still, which you desperately need to be with the Theremin. I like to brace myself. Sitting for me has not worked as well, but I am trying to learn how to do it, because I think it's good to have both. Because when you're, I don't know how people do it who just stand there and do it. You must have really strong butt muscles and a very strong core to be able to do that, because I can't. I am all over the place, and then of course the pitch goes wonky. So is that what you meant by the personal theremin approach? Oh, and the vibrato, I tried all the different ones, doing it on the diagonal. I watched what everybody did, and from the beginning, one of the most pleasing vibratos to me is Amethyst Spardell. When she was first learning the theremin, she posted a YouTube video of her playing Silent Night on, it's not the ether wave, it's the one that looks like a miniature or a smaller version of the RCA, but it's a modern one. And it was so beautiful, and her vibrato was so gorgeous. It just had a beauty to it that just it was limpid and just gorgeous, but not it wasn't that. It had energy, but it was just beautiful. And I think her vibrato is my favorite of everybody, because there isn't the tension that sometimes happens, the machine gun thing that happens, and that's tension. Or it's what people like. There are singers who have that, especially a lot of French singer, that, the Edith Piaf kind of vibrato. And I have a lot of friends who have that kind of vibrato in their singing, and people love it. and it's great for certain things. It's just for my theremin playing, I want like a really beautiful string vibrato. In fact, I asked my cello friend, my cello playing friend, you know, it's like, how do you get a good vibrato? You know, and she said, you just have to keep playing with it until you find a vibrato that's pleasing to you. And then you just try to replicate it. You know, it's something that singers go through. I went through it with my voice teacher of trying to get the vocal tension out of my vibrato so that it was a natural, good vibrato. And I do try to replicate that. In fact, I did a show called Music of the Night in cabaret, which was my one woman show, and there was a lot of theremin in it. And a musician friend of mine, and I valued this comment, you know, she said, I finally understand what you're trying to do with the theremin. It's like you're replicating your voice. It's like I can't tell when you're singing and when the theremin is playing, that they sound so similar. And of course, that's my approach with it. And I was so glad that she got it. You know, what I was trying to do is make it so that is it Sarah or is it the theremin? And, you know, it's what I love also about the theremin is that I can do repertoire that I can't do as a singer, especially the kind of voice that I have. I'm a very light coloratura lyric soprano, and I love Puccini, but my voice just never fit it. So I can play all these Puccini arias, you know, as a man, as a tenor, as a, you know, I can play things that I find so beautiful, and I've always wanted to do, but I couldn't because I didn't have the instrument vocally for it. So the theremin allows you to be a man, a woman, a tenor, a bass, you know, whatever you want, and it's great fun. And I also find that playing Mozart is really, really good because you can't hide. Mozart has to be very clean, and so when I need to pull myself back in, I always practice Mozart arias because, or you know, oratorio or whatever, because you have to be so clean with it, and that helps me. You know, that's just me. I do, you know, I have my warm up arpeggios and scales and all that kind of stuff just to get the placement back in. that I like to do, but everybody's different. There are people who never warm, you know, who never do any exercises and just play. And that's fine too. It's just everybody's different. As a professional singer, I'm just used to doing these. It's like bar work for a ballerina, you know. You've got to do your pliés and your basic stuff in order just to pull yourself back in again to the cleanliness of the technique. And so I find Mozart really helpful for that. It doesn't even have to be difficult Mozart, but it just does have to be very, very clean. You can't fake it. And so that's, you know, that's what I use. There are other people who don't. I read music, so you know, there are other people who don't, and it's fine. It's just everybody's different. And everybody uses their best approach to center themselves to be able to play as well as they can. What's my favorite movie using theremin music? Well, I love Bernard Herrmann, you know, that stuff. excuse me, also, you know, Rocha, is that how you pronounce it? Rocha, the you know, Spellbound and all that stuff. Rob Schwimmer plays the theme from the love theme, I think, from Spellbound, and it's so beautiful, and I just love it, and I want to learn that. You know, he just plays it gorgeously, and it's I did a cabaret evening with him. At 54 Below in New York City, and we did the barcarolle from Hoffmann together. You know, two Theremins on the stage at 54 Below, that was a first. And he played the Spellbound theme, the love theme, and people came up to him afterwards and they said, I burst into tears, it was so beautiful. I have never been moved like that before. It was so, because he's so passionate as a player, and you know, he's such a good musician too. And they said, I've never been moved like that by music. They just burst into tears. So that was very, very cool. I was still fairly early on in my technique, and so you know, I mean, I did the best that I could with what I had. But you know, Rob has been doing it for like 20 years, and he's such a professional, and you know, everybody has such respect for him as a musician too. I seem to be doing the mothership thing again with the eyeglasses. Second here. Let me move this over. Okay. Is that a little better? Yes. Okay. As long as I keep my head down. Well, as long as I don't do this. So anyway, he's fabulous, and I am thrilled that he's part of our community. And that's you know, the movie music. Oh, and I love Ed Wood too. I learned the overture to Ed Wood for Halloween. We would do these Halloween concerts, and you know, I love the Ed Wood stuff. And actually, that's where Lydia was so kind to me, to help me figure out, you know, what the actual theremin part was and stuff. And you know, as I say, she's been extremely kind and generous to me, so I appreciate that. Let's see, Irina Koval. Dear Sarah, when did you get introduced to the theremin? I first heard the theremin, and this is a question that is also later, but I had stopped singing for about 8 years. I had a family tragedy, and I couldn't sing because I would just want to scream, and I just couldn't sing. My throat would close up, and because for me, singing is such an emotional thing. And so I had just gotten back into singing, and I was doing a concert of classical music that was composed by theater composers. And they, so that, we were rehearsing at Tom O'Horgan's house. He was the Broadway director of Hair. He was directing this concert. And he collected musical instruments. He had, people would send him musical instruments from all over the world. There were Tibetan temple bells hanging from the ceiling, and an entire wall of different wooden instruments, and harpsichords, and all kinds of stuff. And he had an RCA theremin, and he let me play it, which was no more than woo, you know, this kind of thing. But the sound enthralled me. It was a cross between a cello and a woman singing, and you couldn't tell what it was. And it just so intrigued me. And of course, the RCAs have such incredible depth of overtones to it. And it's my dream someday to have one. I would love to have one. I got to play on Olivia Mattis's one before. She donated it to the museum in New York. But she would let me come over a couple times and play on it. And oh my God, I loved it. It has such rich overtones that it gets you in the heart like a cello does. Whereas the modern ones, because they're digital, they don't have that kind of depth to them. You know, and so it's like something is missing with the modern ones. Although you use what you can with it. You use what you can, what you have access to. If I had several thousand dollars, I would get a subwoofer and a really good sound system. But right now I'm just using headphones when I practice at home, and which I'll explain later, this Peaceable Hour thing that I've been doing where I play every week, just a little monitor because it's supposed to be very quiet. But God, I would love to have one of those big mofo sound systems, you know, with the real bass and stuff. But even so, you're not going to get the same kind of overtones that you do with a real RCA. And I wish, you know, pray to the gods of whatever, or the goddess of whatever, that I will someday get one, because I would really love that. Just a little bit more. Is that better or worse? It's so hard. This is all such a learning curve. Anyway, all right. So that's when I got introduced to the theremin. It was 20 years ago, because it was right after 9/11. It was right during 9/11 that we were rehearsing, and so it's been like 20 years ago that I first heard it, and I thought I must have this in my life. And of course, it took me many years to do it, but that's when it first struck me, and it just was so incredible. What impressed me the most about the theremin when you heard it for the first time, the fact that it sounded like a cross between a woman singing and a cello. And it was just otherworldly sounding to me. Even not being able to make music on it, just the sheer sound of it was so beautiful to me, and it stayed with me forever. And that's what made me want to do this. How long did it take for me to learn how to properly play my first musical composition on the theremin? Okay, it took me about 2 years before I didn't suck. It doesn't mean that I didn't play in concert. Before that, my friends who were classical musicians couldn't stay in the same room with me. It was like trying to tame a wild animal, and because everything you do has an effect on it. So, you know, this was I had borrowed a friend's theremin that he used for Halloween, and it had no amenities to it, you know, and the antenna was a little crooked, and you know, it had seen better days, but you know, at least it was a start. And it would make wild animal sounds, you know, if you forgot to mute it, it would go or that was my favorite, and that would make the audience laugh. So it became like kind of a joke. And my classical friends, the first time she heard me play it, we would do these concerts to try to learn how to perform in public with each other. And, you know, and there was an audience and everything, but it was way upstate where no one would see it but us. Because you have to learn by doing. You can't learn this stuff in a vacuum. But anyway, they had to sit in the back, and she literally stuffed her fist in her mouth and ran out laughing in tears, laughing so hard. And for a couple years, you know, they would have to leave the room when I would start to play, because you never knew what was going to happen, you know, with the sound, and just, again, learning how to control it. You know, and you'd be going along in pitch, doing just fine, then all of a sudden you'd go off pitch, and it became like a comedy act. And one of the highest compliments a friend of mine said to me, who's a professional singer, years later, you know, she said, "You're no fun anymore. You're not, you know, you're good now. You're not funny anymore. You know, because you've gotten proficiency on it." So it's just, but I practiced every day. I practiced for an hour at least every day. With it, and you know, you get better slowly, really slowly, and you have good days and bad days, and if you're in a bad mood, that shows. The theremin picks up on everything. It to me, it's almost like a spiritual thing of where it just totally reads you. I have to be in a good mood to play it, or it shows. And you know, that it's kind of mystical in a way, but you also have to just learn technique, and the only way that you learn the technique is just by practicing an hour at least every day. And it's just practice, 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 practice. And you know, 6 years later, you know, I'm still trying to play things well. You know, and you, of course, as the bar gets higher, you want to play more difficult things, and so that takes a bit of you know, practicing too. So it just never ends if you want to keep playing it. But it took a good 2 years to where I could play something relatively in tune. And also, as a singer, what I hear inside, because my voice comes from inside of me, I tend to sing slightly sharp, just a tiny, tiny bit sharp. So for the first 2 years, my theremin playing was really sharp. In a lot of times, because that's what I was used to doing. So I've had to learn with the theremin to be more in the dead center of the pitch. There's a great app you can get for your phone called Instune, and it teaches your ear. It's by Wittenberg University. It's a free app, or $1.98 or something like that, that you can put on your phone, and it's a game that you play with yourself to hear whether something is sharp or flat, and it'll play two pitches, and then you have to swipe one way or the other depending on whether you think it's sharp or flat, the second one from the first pitch, and the increments get smaller and smaller and smaller, but it really teaches you how to listen. And so that was one major adjustment I had to make from being a singer to a theremin player, was of adjusting where I was hearing the pitch, you know, of trying to be in the center as much as possible so that it wouldn't go sharp on me. I tended to go sharp more than flat, I think, although, you know, I call it Schrodinger's theremin. You know, I can be sharp and flat at the same time. You know, it's it's an adventure to learn how to corral tame the wild theremin, but practice is really the only way through it, I think, and having other people tell you, you know. And I play for an Alzheimer's group, which was interesting, and because they believe that music helps with dementia, and it does, because it accesses a part of the brain that is not so much affected by dementia. And they would sit there, and it was fascinating, because anytime I veered off pitch with anything, even if it was just for a note, they'd go, they responded so much to it. And that was fascinating. And so, you know, it was like, okay, you just have to keep working on it. And of course, you know you're out of pitch, but the note's gone, and you know there's nothing you can do about it at that point. You know, but it's just learning how to control your hands so that you can control the pitch better. But it was fascinating to see the visceral reaction every time one note would drift off pitch or something. It wasn't in the center of the note. So that was a good learning experience too. Musical to play with. So learning to play the composition, I'm still, you know, it's like I'm never satisfied. I hate listening to myself sing, and I've been on Broadway, I've done concerts all over the world, and whenever I listen to myself singing, I want to swallow Drano and stop singing forever, because I'm such a perfectionist. And it's the same, you know, it's the same way with the theremin. you know, I have a hard time listening to myself because I'm really hard on myself. And I'm trying to learn to be better with that, you know. I mean, it's good to be constructive and to know that you need to fix it, but of not making it a validation that I am just putrid. You know, of thinking of it more technically, that, okay, this needs to be fixed, that needs to be fixed. Just keep working at it and you'll get it done. The what advice do I have for someone who is just starting to learn how to play the theremin? Practice, practice, and practice. Armin Raw is a friend, and he told me that when he got his first theremin, he spent 9 hours the first day learning how to play Summertime, because that's what he wanted to play on it. And so it really is just about practice. I've watched Torvald and Katika and Amethyst, you know, people improve. I mean, we all, you know, Torvald started before me, but Amethyst and Katika started at about the same time. And I've just watched them get better because they're good at practicing. They play. You know, Amethyst spends hours just playing, and so does Katika. And they know how to, the thing about Katika, because she's a professional violinist, and she does the really hard stuff, she knows how to practice as a musician certain things. There was also a book that I read on practicing, and that you just don't start at the beginning and keep going to the end, and start at the beginning and going to the end. What you do is you pick middle sections of it, you start from different places, and you work on getting the technique of it, and then you go away from it, do something else, and then come back to it and see how much you retain. And that has been very helpful to learn how to actually do something. That you listen, you understand what went wrong, and then you work on fixing it, and then you go away from it for a while, do something completely different, and then come back to it and say, okay, you keep testing yourself. You go away and you keep testing yourself. It's called leveraging. And you know, you go and do something else, come back, and that's how you retain the best. That it's the old school of, you know, you just keep doing it over and over and over, doesn't help, because all that does is it gets it into a different part of the brain. This gets it into the long-term memory, evidently, and that it's where you make real progress. So that's what I would say to a beginning thereminist. Just listen to different videos. You're gonna hear videos where people suck and are learning, and it's all okay. You know, everybody's trying their best. You know, I have tons of really sucky videos out there of me playing the theremin, because you have no control over that. If I had control, none of it would be out there, but I don't. So it's just out there for everyone to see your torn underwear, you know, as you're going off pitch with the theremin and stuff. And you know, that should give you hope. But you know, I don't know what to make of the theremin-y. You know, if it makes you want to play, then that's a good thing, I would say. Even if you don't ever play for anybody but yourself, it's, you know, if it makes it affordable, and to me it looks like a George Foreman grill. But I, you know, if it's going to make you spark an interest in it, then I'd say go for it. And you know, you'll move into other instruments, because it's like kittens. You can't have just one. You have to, you know, I don't know of anyone who just has one theremin who's been playing for a while. Because they all sound different and they all have a different quality to them. So, okay, I'm droning on and on. I'm sorry if this is boring. So I'm still learning to play things properly. It's an ongoing thing for the rest of your life. let's see, could you please tell us about my experience playing the Marietta's house? Okay, we kind of already touched on that. It was an amazing, life-altering thing. to be at Tom O'Horgan's house and seeing all these instruments and hearing the theremin. My fondest memories of that time is that I survived 9/11 too. I've survived COVID and I've survived 9/11. I was down there at the World Trade Center working a night job, and I felt the planes hit and saw the bodies jump out of the window and all that kind of stuff, and that forever changes you. The lucky thing was is that I knew to get out of there, so I just started walking home and I did not get covered in that toxic dust. But but that whole time of you know, the 9/11 and getting back into singing, and that was very healing. So yeah, that was 9/11 time. That was not a great time, but it was a life-altering time. Mashinka, you are the core organizer of the largest theremin group on Facebook. Really? Would you please tell us about this initiative? And why was this important to you? Okay, when I first started playing the theremin, and I was seeking advice from more experienced people, and this was when it was still a Google group, the LevNet Google group. And there were some people who were extremely helpful and gave me great advice, or good advice of how to even access knowledge. People were very generous to me. I can't think of his name right now, but he sent me the, and I thank him profusely for this, he sent me the Clara Rockmore book, and tones, a whole set of tones to match, you know, so that I could do the workbook and stuff. And that was so helpful. And old, and I don't know if I'm pronouncing this correctly, old Tekamakula or whatever his name was, he was so helpful, you know, and in finding repertoire and all of that kind of stuff. But there were others, and I will not mention their names because we all know who they are, who were so awful and hurtful. And, you know, I didn't need to be told that I was great, but all I was told was how much I sucked and how bad I was, you know, that it was never going to get any better, blah, 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 all this stuff, you know. And they wouldn't tell you how to make it better. That's all I wanted to know was, how do I make it better? How can I improve? And we found it so hurtful. And it wasn't just me. They were extremely dismissive of anyone who wasn't Clara Rockmore or themselves. And it just, it was so awful. And so when LevNet moved to Facebook, I had to block this individual, because it was just so toxic. It was making me not want to play anymore. And I would privately talk with other people who were having the same experience. They were, you know, crying, devastated. Again, because it wasn't constructive criticism. It was destructive criticism, because they didn't tell you how to improve it. And, you know, that it was extremely dismissive, I felt. So, Amethyst Spardell and I and Dean Rose, we decided we would start our own group, and that we wouldn't let the assholes in, that it had to be a place of safety and experimentation and growth, that it was going to be like our little magic garden, secret garden, that thereminists could come to for information and share all things love of theremin. And that's what it became. And, you know, we don't allow criticism, because we're critical enough. You know, I mean, you can hear it. You can hear it when you're off pitch, and everybody's at different levels. And we wanted it to be a safe place for people to show their learning videos, you know, of, you know, last month I couldn't play this on pitch. This month I'm, you know, 60% closer on pitch, and it's great. And you know, people, it's been a very supportive environment. People have shared information of how to help each other become better, and that's what we really want. Or, you know, information that you can't get too many places. There's, you know, it's like there, when I first joined these groups, it was like, how do you even find out this information? And of course, you know, many of the same people from the Facebook LoveNet group are on there, and I love Olivia Mattis. You know, she's a fabulous person. She's so intelligent, and you know, she didn't mean it to be that way, because that's not her at all. But she also wasn't going to block the ones that were destructive, and we have no problem blocking the destructive people, because I don't want it in that environment. It makes it into a toxic soup, and it's just too destructive. So that's why we started this group, and it has become, it's just grown exponentially, and I'm thrilled, because it encourages all kinds of music. I mean, that was the other thing with this person, that if it wasn't classical music, then, you know, it was shit, pardon my French. But, you know, that it just wasn't worth anything and all that kind of stuff. And it was, that's stupid, because music comes in all forms. It's what you need to express with it. And we're all gonna find our ways with it, and it's all valid. And if you're a beginner, you're valid too. You know, you've got to start somewhere. Nobody comes out of the womb being able to play the theremin, unless you're a theremin, or you're Peter Theremin, or whatever. But you know what I mean, that it's like, it takes a truckload of practice to be able to do this. And you're gonna do it in small increments, and it sometimes it feels like, you know, you take one step forward and two steps back for a while until you figure out what's going on. And we wanted it to be, we wanted the Theremania to be a group to share all things for the love of theremin. And you know, they say love is love is love, and love is stronger than whatever, and I believe that's true. That if you build on a foundation of love for something, it's gonna be a lot stronger. And so I'm thrilled that we're almost at 1,000 people. And, you know, who knew that there were even 1,000 people interested in the theremin? So that's very exciting. And I have to thank Dean Rose, because he's been the dad of the group. And he is a dad in real life, so he knows how to handle personalities that can be troublesome, because we just don't want it in there. You know, we want it to be a pleasurable place of learning and growing and feeling free to experiment and show what you know. It's like refrigerator art, you know, that your kids draw on sometimes, you know, where it's like, we're proud of the fact that people want to share their learning experience with it, because I think it helps. I think it helps us all. And Katika has been great with certain things of advice, or her frustrations with it early on, where, you know, she felt like all she could do was make motorcycle sounds on it, which she posted a video of, which I thought was very funny. You know, and she's become quite adept over time with it, but she had a lot of frustration in the beginning, and I think by sharing that with all of us, that it's okay to be frustrated. You're learning something new. That's the other thing in this memory book that I read of how to learn, is that to know that when you're learning something that's unknown to you, that it's going to be difficult, and it's okay to fail. And it's okay, you know, what's not okay is to not pick yourself up and go on and try to learn from it. But the failure is part of it. And to be ridiculed for it in in the other group, to me, just was not right. It just did not feel right. So it was like, damn it, we're gonna make our own group where we can have safety to share and to learn and to grow and fall down and get up and learn. And I'm really proud of all of us because people are extremely generous. You know, if someone has a question, a bunch of people will answer and help. And it's just really great. So I'm thrilled with it. Let's see, why was this important to you? Well, I've explained that, why it was important. It was a place, we needed a place where you weren't gonna get hurt irrevocably by some mean sniping, you know, because they didn't like the color of your curtains. You know, it was that arbitrary. And, or, you know, they didn't like you because you were fat. And, you know, that's just inexcusable to me. And that's not professional and it's not kind. And we wanted a place that was kind. And so that's what we've done. In another very long-winded, I've yacked on much longer than I thought I was going to. Okay. Do you think that the theremin itself affects the listener more than any other musical instrument? In good and bad ways, yes. When I first was learning, people had to run out of the room, and even when I got more proficient on it, I still have had people say, I can't stand that thing. It wigs them out, because it's not a norm. I've also had people say to me, it has moved me deeply, and it's so otherworldly, it becomes extremely spiritual. We've had people, I play this group called, with a group called Peaceable Hour. You can go to the website and see it, where I play the theremin and I sing, and it's a couple other singers. And we just do an hour of the most beautiful, soothing music that we possibly can. And I've had people come up to me and just burst into tears because they felt so released by the beauty of the music, the healing aspect of it. So, you know, the theremin, it falls into two camps. I've had people who absolutely adore it and people who can't stand it. Even as I, having nothing to do with proficiency, they just don't like it. For me, music is a communication tool. For me, it's the main line of the universe to communicate the human condition. And what I love about the theremin is that you can do things on it that are so expressive, and the sound. And so, whether it's, you know, I think this is one of those instruments that has probably more polarity in its detractors and its lovers of it than I've ever seen, because nobody hates a cello if you can play in tune. And, you know, nobody hates a harp. I play the harp too, and I play the piano. Not well, I'm very remedial with it, but the thing I like about the harp is that you don't have to be real good to have it sound pretty. Whereas with the theremin, nobody outside of the theremin community knows how fiendishly difficult it is to play well. And but when you do it well, it can be expressive in a way that very few other instruments can, and I like that. And I have been able to move people as I've gotten better in ways that you know, I mean, I get it with the singing too, but it's just its own thing, and I love that. And I love the spiritual nature of it. You know, the fact that you're, I like to say that it is a very spiritual thing, because you can't see anything, but it has an effect. And you know, you're not touching anything, obviously, but you know, as I've gotten better, people have been more and more moved by things, and because they're not being distracted by an off-pitch note. It's not being pulled out of its expression by technical deficiencies, I guess is the best way to put it. So yeah, do you feel personal contact with the theremin other than not touching it? Yes. When I'm most in my zone, which I call mainlining the universe, I feel so at one with the instrument. You know, I don't know if I'm more in tune then or whatever, but one of the advantages of this Peaceable Hour thing is because it was every week, it forced me to practice, because I had a deadline, and then because in Peaceable Hour we don't have applause, and we're kind of off to the side, we're more ambiance, that it becomes just totally about the music. And I have felt at one with the pianist, you know, that we became like a dance partner, single unit together in a way with the theremin that, and singing too, but that doesn't happen in a performance, because, you know, performance is, you know, what do you look like? What do you, how are you presenting yourself? Blah, 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 and all these other things, and what's going to go wrong. So, that yes, I do feel very much personal contact with my theremin. And my theremin's name is Uma Theremin. Let's see, is it important? I think in order with it, for any musician, I think feeling a personal at oneness with your instrument is a very important thing. I mean, and I think most achieve it. But you only get there from practicing. And practicing and practicing and practicing and practicing. It's really familiarity. That's one thing I learned with doing this concert series upstate too for 15 years, that it's just the repetition of doing it, of you know, having to perform a song or a musical piece, you know, in front of an audience over and over and over again really helps. I did the Fantastics for 2 years on downtown on Sullivan Street in the original production, and you learn things during a long run because you're out on stage every night, 8 times a week, no matter how you're feeling, unless you can't, obviously, and it that becomes your comfort place. A friend of mine who's a singer went to a coach who taught her a sports analogy. She said you have to find your safe place on stage, meaning with the theremin has to become your safe place. And that only happens through practice and becoming so familiar with it. But the theremin becomes my safe zone. That's where I feel the most me and the most safe. And I think that's really vitally important for a musician. You know, when Rob is playing the piano and playing the theremin, you know, he's in his safe zone. And, you know, that's where he was meant to be. And that's the way I feel. You know, whether anybody else agrees, I don't know, you know, for me. But for me, the theremin is my safe place, as is singing, as is performing, as communicating with an audience. It's where I'm meant to be. It's just what I do. And that just took many, 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 many hours of practice. It doesn't come, I used to, you know, when I first started out, I thought if I was good, I wouldn't have to practice. I wouldn't have to work this hard. And then, when I did Sweeney Todd, I watched Angela Lansbury rehearse, and she went over it and over it. Every spare second was testing herself with these lyrics. She had a little cassette tape player, which tells you how long ago it was. It was a stone tablet. And she would just go over and over and over and over this music. And I thought, well, God, you know, if she if she has to do that, then why am I so hard on myself for having to work hard? You know, so that was a real life lesson. You know, when you see the real ones doing it and how hard they work, you know, it doesn't just spring forth with no effort. Let's see. Okay, could you please tell us your impressions from your visit to Caramore? Caramore is the most beautiful place in the world, and it's like Disneyland for adults. It is one of the most gorgeous places I've ever been, and I was so thrilled to get to be there for 2 summers to play the theremin in the music room, which is, you know, unfortunately Lucy Rosen's did not, her theremin did not work. So it didn't, I wasn't able to play it, but I was thrilled to be there. I mean, my God, the art in there and what they did and everything was so beautiful. And there's this great portrait of Lucy with her theremin, you know, like a, it starts with an A, it's you know, the Akkadian. You know, it's a very Akkadian type photograph, you know, of classical Greek robe, you know, very light Greek robes and the flowing hair. I mean, she looked like a fairy in real life. And her theremin, and of course, they're outdoors in the forest. And I thought, boy, that's a long extension cord. But it's a beautiful painting of her, and that hangs in the music room. And it was the artwork. I'm a big Maxfield Parrish fan, and they brought back rooms from European castles. So, you know, like each room was a room from a castle, and the music room is all, it's everything I love. It was just amazing. And they were very nice there. The problem is that the new regime, I don't think they care about the theremin, and I don't think they've been doing anything since. Unfortunately, one of my last performances there, it was in the middle of a rainstorm, and we know what electrical storms can do to electricity and can do to theremins. And so it blew out my theremin. It started howling in the middle of a concert, and I couldn't get it to stop. The mute button didn't work. And it blew out my iPod, so I didn't have my backing tracks, because they didn't want to pay for a pianist, so I had to use tracks. And it took me about 10 minutes to get everything back. Luckily, I had backup on my phone, so I could use my phone for the tracks, but it blew it out. I had to get it repaired. And it would not stop howling, so I'd have to turn it off to stop it from howling in order to, and then turn it back on, you know, and mute it to play. That was kind of scary. But the electricity there is old. It's from the 20s. And when I talked to Andrew, who repairs RCA theremins, and he's worked on Lucy Rosen's theremin, and he said the electricity in there is from the 1920s. So it's horrible in there. And so it wasn't my fault, but it was a nightmare. It was a nightmare come true. So, you know, I hope, I don't know, and the CEO happened to be there, that performance too, that this all happened, and it was like, talk amongst yourselves, where are you from, you know, don't mind me, you know, and frantically just trying to get things back up and running so I could continue the concert, but I think he thought, oh, this is more trouble than it's worth, and so I don't think that they've had too much theremin there since then. And they wanted to go a different direction and stuff, which I think is a mistake, because I don't think Lucy would be very pleased. I think, you know, championing the theremin and its music was very important to her, obviously. You know, her history is so fascinating. You know, and she gave Lev a place to live and a studio, and supported him for a while so he could continue to develop it. You know, and it was just very important to her. And so, you know, that makes me very sad that they're not championing the Theremin in the way that they were before, although they weren't doing even that much. I mean, you know, they had Catalina. I think Torvald's trying to get there, you know, but I think, you know, it's just, and I don't think Rob's gone back. I don't know if he has or not, but, you know, it's too bad, because Lucy really was a huge champion of the Theremin. It meant a lot to her, and she found it an extremely expressive instrument, and one of great beauty. And of course, she, you know, had a hand-built, a Lev-built one that was done just for her. Now if they can only get it to work. But anyway, so, you know, that I wish that they would champion it more than they have, because people found it fascinating. People were loving it, and in fact, when I did O mio babbino caro on the Theremin, and one of the women who works there, she was British, and she said, "Oh, was that you singing? It was so beautiful. I was so moved by it. It took me back to my childhood and everything I loved in my childhood, and it was so beautiful." And I took that as a really high compliment. It was the Theremin, and you know, and it's just too bad that Caramore is not doing that. But maybe that'll change. Things change depending on who's in charge. And it to me, it felt like the last time I was there that it was just, they were trying to make it more commercial, you know, that they were more concerned with the new bathrooms than they were, you know, in the Theremin. And so we'll see. I don't know, it's out of my control. I would hope that that they would. Anyway, do you think New York is the second motherland of the Theremin? I think the Theremin is worldwide. I mean, you know, New York's connection with the Theremin is because there's so many professional musicians here, but also in LA and other places. But also, you know, because Lev was here developing it and stuff, and the RCAs and stuff, and that was all developed here in New York. So, you know, we're proud of the connection. You know, whether it's the motherland, I don't know. You know, I'm just glad that it was host to Lev Theremin for a while. Do I think that the Theremin has prospects in its development? I mean, the level and direction of performing approach in future. I think we're on a really great track. I think this is the most positive track since like the 50s. I really do. The interest is high because of YouTube. People have access to it. You know, before, no one knew who Clara Rockmore was to start with. And I think the fact that that social media and YouTube and all of that makes this a global thing. And I love the fact that our crazy Theremin band of merry players, you know, our group is from all over the world. I just love the globalness of it, the fact that you know, that we have people in France and England and Yugoslavia and Hungary and, you know, just every place, and Russia, and the fact that we all have a meeting place in the heart, because music is such a universal language. And I'm thrilled with that. So I think people are experimenting and using it in ways. There's I can't remember his name right now, forgive me, I have a brain like a sieve, but he's doing this Merlin thing that will allow, through spatially controlled movements of the Theremin, to switch instruments, to be able to have it sound like a different instrument. And that's kind of cool. You know, people are using it in new age music. They're using it in rock music and in all different kinds of stuff, you know. And I just love that. I love that people are experimenting with it and doing techniques. And I think it's been interesting to see, you know, as Catalina's book came out and people had access to it, that I'm seeing a lot of really clean playing in a lot of players' videos, that, you know, that it wasn't just trying to back into it and figure it out, you know, that this is a technique that's very, very clean. I'm not saying it's the only one, but for playing the cleanliness of classical music, I think it's a great technique. And again, I don't know what the Russian technique is, but it's all good. And I think more people are better now than they have been in a billion years. I really do. I think there was like four people who could do this before, and now we've got hundreds. And you know, everybody's at various levels of different levels, but they're all improving. And I think that it's great. So yes, I think that the development and performance of it, that people have more access to information than they did a long time ago. And I mean, you know, if you were lucky, you could study with Clara. And I sang on her nephew's radio program, Robert Sherman. And of course, at the time, I didn't know that they were related. And my big regret is that I didn't have a chance to study with her. If I had known, but I didn't know. You know, I didn't know the two were connected. And her nephew is really sweet. He champions young singers, and you know, he's out there promoting everyone, which is just so great. And he's kind and he's nice, like evidently she was. Let's see, do you think that the theremin is in the future? So I think the future of the theremin is really great. I mean, we get on Theremin World, I mean on Theremania, we get a lot of requests. We don't, please people, if you want to join Theremania, answer the questions. They're really simple, and it just helps us keep the people who just like to join groups out. So please just answer the questions. It's no big deal. Let's see. Why do I love the theremin? Well, for me, it's an expressive tool and instrument. I shouldn't say tool. Makes it sound like a machine. And I love the sound of it. And I just love so much about it. I think I've gone over that in other conversations. I just love it, and I love the challenge of it. I love the beauty of it. I love the expressiveness of it. I love everything about it, and I love that I've finally gotten technically to a point where I can give pleasure to other people listening to it instead of making them run out of the room. Okay, Maritius. Who is your favorite Russian composer? I have a lot. I can't say just one. I have to say, it depends on my mood of what I want to hear. I love Russian music. I love Rimsky-Korsakov. I love Prokofiev. I love Rachmaninoff, of course. Tchaikovsky, Stravinsky, Glier. I've sung a bunch of Glier, and I played, you know, I have a bunch of stuff on the harp for Glier, and Glinka, and all of those guys. It just depends on what I'm in the mood for to listen to. I love the soulfulness. I love the passion of the Russian soul. And I just love the music. And so that was a hard one to answer with just one. So I have a bunch that I love of the Russian composers. Volodya, what would you like to ask Lev Theremin if you had the opportunity to meet him personally? Well, my dad was an inventor and an electronic engineer, and I've inherited a little bit of his brain, but not much. But I love the logic of it, and it just would be interesting to talk to him to see if how he comes up with this stuff. He came up with so many interesting things in the whole spatially controlled instrument and stuff, and the whole thing with the radio waves and realizing that you know it had pitch, and you know, I just think he'd be a very interesting man to have dinner with, you know, if you could have a dinner conversation, my dinner with Lev. I would love that, you know, because his technique of the theremin was very different from what we do today. You know, but nobody has been able to duplicate what he did as far as the sound, in my opinion. And I just, you know, I hope I win the lottery so that I can get myself an RCA and have that sound in my life. But, and just to thank him for even conceiving of this thing. You know, he was a fascinating person, and I think there's an opera there, in his life story, which could be very interesting. So anyway, that's it. That's all she wrote. That's all the questions. Thank you so much for sticking with me. I have, my God, this is almost, I've almost been yakking on for 2 hours, an hour and a half at least. Thank you for sticking with me. If there's anything you want to ask me, you can, I think the text will go across the screen. Is there anything you want to ask? Hello. Does anybody want to ask anything that I haven't already droned on about for hours and hours? Yes? No? Is there like text? Is there texting here? Okay, if nobody has any questions, I'm gonna go. You know, thank you. This was really enjoyable. As I say, I've been stuck at home for, you know, like 4 months, and we're all becoming feral. You know, it's so it was nice to be human today for change. I really enjoyed it, and thank you for asking me. And I hope that something I said was useful to somebody. And please, you know, thank you for being part of our community. I'm really proud of our little community. I'm proud of each and every one of you for you know, moving through this and moving forward in this instrument. And it's a fabulous adventure. And I'm glad that we're all sharing it together. And, you know, anything you want to ask on the Theremania site, you know, we will, someone's always monitoring, so we, you know, we can answer. And be well, everyone, please be well. We want you all safe and well. And onward to play the theremin together. All right. Love you all. Thank you. Bye. Thank you, Peter.